I'm Ian Shapiro, and I'm delighted to be here. I was instructed to be tougher than Harry has been, which is quite a rush, because as Georgia will attest, when we were all assistant professors at Yale way back when, we were all terrified of Harry Frankfurt. So it's a real challenge to be tougher than Harry, but I'll do my best. Our speakers will, we have Axel Honneth, unfortunately, is not here today, and so we have three speakers. It is billed as a round table. Our speakers will have up to 20 minutes each. We'll then ask Michael to speak for up to 10 minutes, and then open it up, and our objective is to end by 6:15, not 6 o'clock, as it says on the program. Everybody who's here these few days, I think, has probably spent some time thinking about what they find distinctively admirable about Michael as a political theorist, and I've thought about this a great deal. He took me on as a graduate student in the years after he had left Harvard, and was the effective supervisor of my dissertation long distance, and I've always been greatly indebted to him and admired him very much. And I was thinking, what is it that is Michael's inimitable mix? And I think it comes from the fact that some political thinkers are unusually creative, and some political thinkers are unusually thoughtful. But it's often the case that creativity and thoughtfulness don't go together very much. But I think what's inimitable and enviable about Michael is he's really one of the most creative and one of the most thoughtful and reflective people I've ever met. And I think that part of the, I know we're not to be talking about essentialism, but part of the essence of his distinctiveness lies in that. But nobody came here to listen to me today, so I will now stop. We'll start with Mitchell.
Thank you. Is it functioning? Yeah, okay. Should we trust intellectuals?
Next paper.
This may seem an odd question with which to begin an appreciation of Michael Walzer's work, yet it's implied in arguments he makes on a wide range of subjects, as if he were reasserting his own connected criticism of intellectuals, especially philosophers, more precisely of philosophers who engage politically while speaking abstractly, who make their own designs or vocations primary, rather than arguing through the stuff that comprises the lives and values of the society in which they live. There is, Michael writes, nothing to worry about when philosophers talk to one another, but problems do arise when philosophical conversation departs its own sphere to displace political argument, or when freedom or the idea of conversation among equals becomes so abstract that democracy becomes meaningless. Walzer protests conversational designs that make it hardly necessary to have a conversation. In contrast, I quote him, real talk is reflection become articulate. It is ever unstable, restless, reaches to reasons and arguments that its participants cannot anticipate. So to answer my opening question, should we trust intellectuals, depends a great deal on who the we is and the relation of the critic to the we. I want to explore this in a few steps, beginning with a look at some particularly forceful claims made by Michael. I'll also try to contextualize them within a certain kind of democratic left, also within some of the philosophical and political arguments of the last decades in which Walzer participated, particularly focusing on a number of opposing positions, some at a little length, which I think bring out the strengths of Michael's argument. Then I'll offer a few connected critical questions of my own. A critic, Walzer asserts, must begin arguments within his or her society and culture rather than pretend to step outside so as to assert abstract principles for it. This particularism may seem conservative, since conservatives insist so often that established traditions must trump alternative or universal ways of thinking. But Walzer's argument is informed, it seems to me, by a radical reformist impulse. Call it social democratic. Social in the sense that a critic does not flee a society's thickness, its values, meanings, life, and democratic in the sense that the critic should not conceive him or herself to be beyond the men and women who comprise the society. Critical distance is not conflated with detachment. Call this a decent respect for their opinions and their common sense, instead of considering them forever unenlightened inhabitants of Plato's cave or inevitably tyrannical majority. The allusion to the Declaration of Independence is important, it seems to me, and not beside Walzer's point, not because he wants to prove natural rights, but because he wants to tease social democratic understandings out of American political culture. A connected critic persuades by interpreting, reinterpreting, questioning meanings shared by fellow citizens, challenging them, nursing change and new perspectives from within. This hermeneutics of reform also serves as a corrective to intellectual hubris. It suggests that a critic's persuasive standing depends on modesty, and it deparochializes intellectual activity. Your voice shares what you interpret. It doesn't announce decrees that you've discovered or invented or seen. The connected critic and Sartre's engaged writer are opposites. Radicalism for Sartre requires you to reject socialization, while heroic acts of stepping back may continually marginalize you, they enable you to guard universal values that may be jeopardized by your society or the nature of bourgeois society. But if values are created socially, if they formulate shared understandings of people wrestling with the problems thrown forth by life, and these are those historical circumstances, marginality is not very helpful, and those universal values may be less compelling than they are thin. Marginal critics, Walzer calls them conventional, share a conceit, a heroic conception of their own role in thought. This sort of person may indeed be more articulate or learned or insightful than others when distressful or evil developments arise, yet that is why he or she should detach from marginality, not from society. Consequently, the language of criticism, conceived in a broad moral and cultural sense, must be shared by critic and society. You don't present yourself as an enemy in order to persuade. You persuade by imminent criticism of established values, customs, political realities. You are, in Walzer's words, the educated cousin or specialist in common complaint, and your protests take form as censure or skeptical challenge or angry prophecy, using a common language raised, in his words, to a pitch of intensity and argumentative power, perhaps like Luther in his pamphlets. Connected criticism, argues Walzer, is an ancient practice. The prophet Amos, for example, was a connected critic in Israelite society of the 8th century, BCE. A new upper class was then callous toward the poor. Amos didn't invite everyone under a veil or a talit of ignorance. For a rational discussion of first principles, he holds up like a mirror the moral myth that constituted the society's identity. Once you were slaves in Egypt, the poor of your day are their moral equivalents and you. Or Locke's letter on toleration works in a similar way. Written when he was physically in Dutch exile, he still spoke from within England, and his target audience was the English elite. He uses a Protestant idiom, particularly the language of personal salvation, in arguing for a new turn in ideas. The point of connected criticism is not just practical, it concerns understanding. Walzer's assessment of Herbert Marcuse's criticisms of American society show why. Marcuse, the sole member of the Frankfurt School to stay in the U.S., portrayed Americans as a nation of happy slaves, so manipulated that they could not see that their promised land was one of bondage, so false in their consciousness that they couldn't recognize how they were victimized by non-terrorist totalitarianism. High culture alone seemed to offer the utopian alternative to semi-literate masses grasping at paperback junk books. This picture of American unfreedom, thinks Walzer, could have been written only by a disconnected critic, that is, a critic who may cite C. Wright Mills, but who's never been in conversation with ordinary Americans, and who has no sensitivity to the imminent value or potential of everyday life. It is, one might add, as if Marcuse thought liberation would be nigh if the unfree began to discuss the possibilities of staging Faust, Act Two, of course. The greater problem, of course, is more specifically political. Such a disconnected critic might well miss the difference between the nationalist populism that forced him into American exile and the democratic populism that helped to mobilize the United States to defeat Nazi Germany. Or he might not recognize the dissimilarity between Gleichschaltung and American conformism. These criticisms of Marcuse place Walzer in the tradition of what of a left intellectual project, which I'll call the dissent left. Dissent magazine, since its founding in 1954 by Irving Howe and a group of like-minded intellectuals, advocated a left committed to participation in American debates on American terms. This may seem a banal point, but not if you consider how much of left intellectual argument has been governed by what were presumed to be universalizing theories. Howe had gone in and out of sectarian left-wing politics, in specific a Trotskyist offshoot that was hostile to Stalinism and capitalism, but insistent on Leninism. Membership in it, he once wrote, provided a coherent perspective on everything. The sect's anti-Stalinism inoculated Howe against communist parties and fellow traveling, but the decisive term was to conclude that an American left had to think and write in the vernacular rather than in the mental universe of, say, the Petrograd Soviet. Accusations that dissent was parochial in its aversion to European high philosophy, or that it represented assent to the ills of American life, missed the point, which was that you had to be connected to the world you wanted to change. And I think it's in this spirit, same spirit, that Michael Walzer later distinguished high-flying universalism, which he called philosophical, and low-flying universalism, which he called political and legal, the first seeking laws to cover all times and places, the latter assuming a reiterative commonality within diverse human experiences. Walzer was Howe's student at Brandeis in the 1950s. He began to contribute to dissent and became its co-editor. He was also a research assistant to Howe and Louis Kozer as they wrote their book on the American Communist Party, A Critical History, 1919 to 1957, against the backdrop of Cold War, the Soviet invasion of Hungary. It was a time of widespread debate on pluralism, totalitarianism, and conformism in the worlds of political theory and, more broadly, political science. One way to think of Walzer's notion of connected criticism is that it's at the point where the dissent left cross-fertilizes with common sense moral argument. This type of moral argument has a distinguished lineage that goes back to Aristotle's demurral from Plato's dismissal of common opinion. Aristotle remarks, Henry Sidgwick gave us, quote, the common sense morality of Greece reduced to consistency by careful comparison, given not as something external to him, but as what he and others think ascertained by reflection. Moral philosophy thus doesn't discover or invent truths, but begins with the moral opinions of ordinary people, the point being to make explicit the implied premises of our common moral arguments. Walzer has a comparable starting point, but the purpose is not simply to render premises explicit, it's to make meaning socially transformative. He writes, the moral and social worlds are more or less coherent, but they're never more or less coherent. Morality is always subversive of class or power, and it is subversive because it's interpreted and not considered timeless. That is, you can go up against the value, underlying values against the society's reality, or you can stretch them to challenge the society. But this means that criticism works only through the particular, that is, by linking substantive moral claims to substantive local life and knowledge. In interpretation and social criticism, three paths in moral philosophy are distinguished: discovery, invention, interpretation. Each takes to different grounds, the first actually to the heights exemplified by Mount Sinai. Morals here are discovered, more precisely revealed, or so it's believed, as commandments. In a more secular version, someone, say a philosopher, imagines his or her mind free of distortions of time, place, or self, and reasons to a God's or nature's eye view. No pre-existing design is found on the path of invention, just circumstances that enable men and women to fashion rules to govern common life. So Rawls, whom Walzer calls a minimal inventor, invites us into an imaginary original position that eliminates particularizing interests and thereby allows rational exchange to formulate first principles for a pluralistic society. Walzer objects that in arguments like these, the end is given by the morality we hope to invent if we bracket our particular, our lived particulars of life. They render superfluous real democratic argument, the medium of self-determination of citizens making decisions on the basis of socially agreed on meanings in a world of contingencies. Walzer's metaphoric alternative to an original position, or Habermas's ideal speech situation, is a home conceived as a moral community. In his description, it is, and I quote, occupied by a single family over generations with unplanned additions here and there, and all the available space filled with memory-laden objects and artifacts. The path of interpretation brings us there and through its contours or corridors. Although I wonder if a mix of metaphors here indicates something of a problem, because a home is a stable destination, why shouldn't the path continue on? Yet whether it's a path or a home, interpretive moral argument becomes a matter of thick description by a connected critic rather than articulation of a thin theory or regulative abstract principles. A connected critic's interpretive argument gives an account of existing morality within the home, for it's there that the democratic arguments must take place. Walzer thus inverts the procedure of what he calls law-covering universalism, which seeks to discern principles beyond the common world of particular societies. For him, the maximal, the thick, precedes the minimal, the thin, and so he argues in Thick and Thin that apparently freestanding moralities are really the product of experience. They designate some reiterated feature of particular thick maximal morality. A connected critic criticizes among people who, as citizens, share responsibility for one another. They determine their lives together, hence the importance of national self-determination for Walzer. And if you live among them, you may rightly criticize the arrangement of the furniture. If your home is elsewhere, if you imagine it is everywhere, or if you stand outside in the sunlight with Plato's philosopher and perhaps Leo Strauss, would keep apart from unphilosophers living inside, you may be regarded appropriately with skepticism. Walzer and Strauss have something in common. Interpretation is central to their endeavors. Consequently, they're both liable to a traditional challenge to hermeneutic approaches. How can you be sure of your interpretation? But Walzer is at home in Plato's cave in argument with its inhabitants, and Strauss is at home either when he basks in philosophical sunlight, that is, when he's reading Plato's Republic, or alternatively in the Nocturnal Council when he's reading Plato's Laws. It's easier for Walzer to reply to the challenge because he thinks we never fully know, and conversations are never finished because they're always open to revision in a world of contingencies. Strauss, in contrast, has a problem partly because of his assertion of natural right and philosophy against relativism. Strauss also has a problem because his theory of reading at least seems to me to have only one plausible conclusion, and that is the validity of your interpretation. Interpretation depends on interpreting like a Straussian. In fact, he thinks it would be better if most people stayed in the cave with their opinions, preferably praying, certainly not reading the latest issue of Dissent magazine. Moreover, Strauss distinguishes political thought from political philosophy. The former is not preoccupied by the difference between opinion and knowledge. Its concern is the particular rather than the truth. Political opinion is the stuff of errors, guesses, beliefs, while political knowledge is about the nature, quote unquote, of political things. Strauss writes, it's only when the here and now ceases to be the center of reference that a philosophic or scientific approach to politics emerges. Or as Lenin might have said, cave dwellers can at best achieve trade union consciousness. Intellectuals attain scientific consciousness when they can step back from the particular interests of daily life or fly high above them to see the whole. A connected critic, in contrast, works through the thick particularity as a comrade of trade unionists, cave dwellers, and common men and women, all those we's. He or she would agree with Strauss's separation of political thinking from political philosophy, but for the sake of the former. There's a striking exchange in Ivan Turgenev's novel, Fathers and Sons, between Bazarov, the young nihilist and champion of a materialist worldview, and a woman with whom he's fallen in love despite himself. Anna Odintseva asks Bazarov why he lacks interest in art. Because it's useless, he responds. She asks, she suggests that it's of help in knowing people and human experiences. He responds that his own life serves him well enough for that. I quote, a single human specimen sufficient to make judgments about the rest. People are like trees in a forest. No botanist would study each birch individually. At another point in the novel, Bazarov is asked if he shares some of Proudhon's views. He answers, I don't share anyone's opinion, I have my own. Bazarov is the hero of Edward Said's book Representations of the Intellectual. The book often reads like a curiously contradictory response by a conventional critic, not a philosopher, to the notion of connected criticism. While Said speaks of the worldliness of texts and relied on Foucauldian notions in Orientalism, here he seems to stress, almost surprisingly, how there must be standards of truth for public intellectuals despite their backgrounds. He protests repeatedly against American intellectuals or the media using the pronoun we. Universality, he contends, must uphold a single standard of human behavior. It demands, in his words, a spirit in opposition rather than accommodation, which he identifies with a metaphysics of exile. For Said, quote, the romance of intellectual life is lonely dissent from the status quo on behalf of the underrepresented and disadvantaged. An intellectual is endowed with, a faculty for representing, embodying, articulating a message, a view, an attitude. But at the same time, Said thinks that the whole point of being an intellectual, quote, is to be embarrassing and even unpleasant, unquote. The intellectual speaks truth to power. It's the voice and the signature that matters. He claims Theodore Adorno because he represented the intellectual as a permanent exile, a thinker who declared his writing to be his homeland. This train of assertions bypasses almost every difficult question that can be raised about intellectuals, as well as the question of whether or not the assertions follow each other. Are representing, embodying, and articulating the same thing? Is a well-argued message the same thing as an attitude? Aren't representing two and representing four different activities that require different justification? Does an intellectual signature entitle him or her to criticize? Do the underrepresented simply dot the I's on the intellectual signature? And if there are urgent matters to be raised, why isn't persuasion the whole point of being an intellectual as opposed to being embarrassing or unpleasant? If you think that there are particular problems in this world that need particular answers, or that there are multiple ways people are disadvantaged, plural dimensions of human oppression, then things become complex for intellectuals. The point might not be a romance of intellectuals, but persuading those around you to find appropriate responses and solutions grounded in the realities of suffering men and women. Said turns to Bazarov because he believes literature grounds the world and, he believes that literature is grounded in the world and can therefore elucidate his claims. It can show, for instance, quote, how the representation of social reality is profoundly influenced, even decisively changed by the appearance of a new actor, the modern young intellectual. Said clearly identifies with the chief protagonist of Fathers and Sons, and his implication seems to be that as Bazarov represented a generational rebellion within Russian's gentry, so Edward Said, a century later, challenged liberal American academic elites. The problem, however, is that Said's representation of Bazarov of an intellectual's life dissolves in the thickness of Russian society and history as described by Turgenev. The novel, according to Said, gives us, and I quote, a provincial Russia in the 1860s that is idyllic and uneventful. In it, property classes inherit habits of life from their parents. They marry, have children, and life more or less moves on. But then Bazarov, who seems like a son, who seems less like a son than a sort of self-produced character, appears and assails mediocrity and cliches. Said notes how this apostle of materialist philosophy even mocks the romanticism of a middle-aged man, father, playing Schubert on the cello. The beauty and pathos of the novel, says Said, is a depiction of the intrusion into the old natural way of doing things of a confrontational intellect. He appears, I quote, he appears, challenges, just as abruptly he dies, infected by a sick peasant he has been treating. Such is Said's Bazarov, but what of the Bazarov of Turgenev? He is, of course, a nihilist and renounces his origins, but the novel presents his journeys from one place to another in Russia, culminating in his failure or escape, a failure to escape or change Russia. His father, a local doctor, him a medical student, when a member of the gentry accuses him of going against his own people, of not being truly Russian, he insists that he is, that his grandfather plowed the earth. A careful reading of Said's book and the text of the novel show us that what Bazarov says, that what Bazarov says, what Turgenev shows, and what Said portrays are very different things. Nihilist rejection doesn't mean that he comes out of nowhere. He must come from within and clash with Russia in order to reject Russia. We see Bazarov doing this throughout the novel. He will end his days on his father's estate. He does not die after treating an infected peasant, as Said says. He succumbs after cutting himself while performing an autopsy on a peasant who's died of typhus. That is, his death comes of his attempt to look inside Russia's central issue. Turgenev already makes clear earlier in the novel that peasants don't recognize Bazarov as a fellow countryman. In one conversation with a peasant, after he leaves, one peasant says to another, this man just is blabbing. He's a gentleman, you know. You think he understands? Do you think he understands anything? It turns out that Bazarov is as distant from the peasants as he is from his own parents. Said seems to invent the Russian world in which the novel takes place. And continuity and discontinuity are much more complex matters than he presents. In fact, at the beginning already, we're on an estate that is being restructured and consciously so in advance of the expected emancipation of the serfs. Precise dating is a characteristic of Turgenev's works. The novel begins on May 20th, 1859. It's published in 1862. Russia is not simply moving on as Said would have it. In the end, we have the signature of the intellectual, but not the reality of Russia's oppressed, the serfs. I've been trying to indicate some problems of what Walzer would call conventional criticism by describing Said's, what I think is misrepresentation of Turgenev. The novel and the society described by the novelist seem to vanish like the birch trees in Bazarov's forest, and Said's signature remains. But here we ought to register a curious feature of his book on intellectuals. When its focus shifts to the Arab-Islamic world, he does not demand that intellectuals speak truth to power. He doesn't recommend that Arab-Islamic intellectuals embarrass or be unpleasant. Instead, he proposes to counter Islamist extremism with quote-unquote interpretation. Islam's complex heterodox nature and can thereby be brought out, allowing it to speak, quote, to the challenges of non-Islamic minorities, women's rights, modernity itself. And to this end, Said calls for a revival of ijtihad, which he defines as personal interpretation. In fact, this misrepresents a Muslim idea that has a complex history. Ijtihad is not simply personal interpretation, but interpretive reasoning by someone with expertise in law, Quran, and various traditions. The expert doesn't apply an abstract universal standard or an outside standard. He reasons out of Islamic learning. Bazarov's way is not that of ijtihad, which is in a curious way closer to a type of connected criticism. Said seems to represent intellectual activity in one manner for Muslims and another for Westerners or Russians. Mujtahid, someone who does ijtihad, would say, I don't share anyone's opinion, I have my own, and neither would a connected critic. I have 2 minutes? So, 2 minutes. Earlier, I suggested that the idea of a connected critic may be regarded as a corrective to intellectual hubris. The assumption is that intellectuals tend to a type of parochialism as concerns their own activity. And after all, have we not had a plentitude of intellectuals in the 20th century who imagined that their ideas are freestanding and who sought to impose them on the world around them to very bad effect? Connected criticism implies that intellectuals are responsible when their starting point is self-consciously socialized. I wonder, however, if connected critics don't also need a correction, not on the basis of imaginary or self-standing principles, but by means of social and historical comparison. In various works, Michael concedes that comparison has heuristic value, but tends to minimize it. When he writes of the sense of affinity he felt with Prague protesters carrying signs that said truth and justice in 1989, he proposes that there is an image of a, quote, core morality differently elaborated in different cultures. He calls it thin in the sense that every society speaks of justice and oppression. We identify with this core morality in a broad sense, but not because we're persuaded by all the social meetings and idiomatic cultural references that make up this particular society and its protest. Thus, we march vicariously with the Prague demonstrators, and this means we are really in our own parade. Things get thick when liberated Czechs and Slovaks begin to determine their future, and this means specification and disagreement that can't be entered vicariously, for we don't share the memories and experiences of this society. Humanity writ large, quote, has membership but no memory. But I wonder if humanity writ large has no memory. And how can we say this if we have not compared ourselves with others in a thicker way? Even if we can finally do nothing other than walk down the thick path of interpretation, is there not a danger on it? A danger that is at least as potent as imagining that our minds or principles are self-standing. I mean the danger of getting lost in the thick of our own path when many thickets grow on it. Would not comparison serve as a useful regulator, even if we can't fully know the idioms of other societies? We can still speak as if we know them well enough. The differences we imagine may also give us useful moral jolts. What may be deployed questionably as knowledge may be useful as a corrective. Thank you.
Good afternoon. One of Michael Walzer's outstanding contributions to political theory is his depiction of the social critic. By following the critical biographies of the personages of the company of critics, Walzer has drawn the contours of this political type and elaborated its unique civil role. The debate surrounding Walzer's conception of political morality and his mode of social criticism has focused on its epistemological assumptions. Walzer's version of the social critic, however, assumes also a unique political posture. It is this aspect of his conception that I seek to elaborate here. Walzer's idea of social criticism, I will argue, is embedded in a robust conception of politics and of membership. Together, they form the circumstances of criticism, making it both necessary and possible. So let's begin with the reach of politics. A common adage of civic discourse declaims in despair, it's all politics, or sometimes it's all political. Politics here may denote self-interest. The statement, usually relating to an issue concerning the public good, tells us then that those people charged with the public good have only their narrow interest in mind when they act and not the public interest. The statement may, however, have a slightly more abstract meaning referring to a completely different divide. The people charged with the public good, on this understanding, are not motivated by values, but by interest. On this reading, the public sphere is denuded of value and dominated solely by interest. The assumptions behind the readings differ as to the place of interest in the management of the common weal, but coalesce on the narrowness of the motivation of the public actors. The only question is, just how narrow? Hence the sense of despair of the political encapsulated in the statement. In the public sphere, dominated by the government of representatives, there is no one who takes the responsibility of representation seriously enough to set aside narrow self-interest. This accusation need not refer to the private interest of the particular representative. It might just as well refer to the interest of a particular political party bent on enhancing its prospects to rule. Self-interest and political power here overlap. This malaise is not new to political life. John Donne put it beautifully and bluntly in his scathing description of life in the Elizabethan court, written to his exiled friend Sir Henry Wotton. And I quote, "Here's no more news than virtue. I may as well tell you Cadiz or St. Michael's tale for news as tell that vice doth here habitually dwell. For here no one is from the extremity of vice by any other reason free than that the next to him still is worse than he." End quote. Donne is acerbic with regard to the political corruption of the Elizabethan court. The public interest or political moralities, perhaps certain ideals, are compromised and devalued. Moreover, the political practice of those very persons charged with the cultivation and implementation of these values deems them irrelevant to the public sphere. That is why despair is often coupled with disgust. The adage I opened with, however, is not unique to the discourse of ordinary citizens muttering it to themselves as they watch the news at the end of the day, or read their paper on the way to work, or declare it round their table to family and friends. There is a learned version of this attitude typical of certain forms of theory. Human relations on this account are webs of power that invite myriad forms of domination. There is nothing unique to the civic sphere in this respect, for human relations are thoroughly political. Politics here is synonymous with domination and use of power. This analysis of the fundamental predicament of human relations gains special weight against the background of a post-structuralist critique of political theory that would run like this. Modernist politics sought to stabilize the divide between violence and authority with regard to political power. But in doing so, argue the critics, this division itself constitutes what we recognize to be violence and thus dramatically determines the area of what is politically relevant in the sense of authorized use of power. Violence is not neutrally given. It is determined, in fact, by the interests of the wielders of institutionalized power. The modernist conception, in fact, hides from sight the degree to which domination inheres in human life and relations. The theoretical version of the adage thus complements the ordinary citizen's response to the public sphere. Both share a despair of the political in the sense of the managing of the public weal. It cannot be done, either because there is no way to set aside, let alone transcend self-interest, or because any attempt to recognize the uniqueness of the public calling is in fact a collaboration with an entire superstructure enshrining the status quo of dominations pervading social life. Both the ordinary citizen and the theorist remind us of the degree to which politics is a linguistically constituted activity. Both go about imparting new meaning to the noun politics or the adjectival form by using them in new discursive practices. Politics colloquially means narrow self-interest and theoretically means any form of domination. Both senses are to be contrasted with the notion of politics as the management of the public good. This is either unachievable or merely a cover-up for the micro-problems that it seeks to camouflage. In other words, if everything is political, then the political is no longer distinctive, nor perhaps relevant. Michael Walzer has for decades shun the temptation to despair of politics. I believe he would say we simply cannot afford it. He worries too much. I join him in this worry. The essay is Michael's main genre of writing, not the academic article or learned treatise. Walzer's writing is a model of joining the discussion, indeed of enhancing it, not because he idealizes political life, but because he realizes that we are embedded in polities that determine our lives and our life prospects. And I quote, "Sovereignty by no means exhausts the fields of power, but it does focus our attention on the most significant and dangerous form that power can take. For this is not simply one among the goods that men and women pursue. As state power, it is also the means by which all the different pursuits, including that of power itself, are regulated. It is the crucial agency of distributive justice. It guards the boundaries within which every social good is distributed and deployed. Hence the simultaneous requirements that power be sustained and that it be inhibited, mobilized, divided, checked, and balanced. Political power protects us from tyranny and itself becomes tyrannical." End quote. In terms of the theory of complex justice and spheres of justice, politics as a human endeavor relates to the sphere of spheres, that which is most inclusive of all other human pursuits and undertaking. Moreover, it is the crucial agency of justice. The despair of politics to the decree it relinquishes the institutionalized government of human life risks, too, an abandonment of justice. This despair may also reflect complacency with regard to civic liberty, insofar as those individuals who enjoy the rights and liberties safeguarded by the modern republics take their liberty for granted. Second-generation Americans still feel the price paid by immigrant parents, the sacrifice that made their own lives possible. For many such Americans, the hyphenated character of their civic identity is a powerful reminder of the promise. We all are indeed bewildered by the great evils perpetrated by the secular nation states of the 20th century, the United States included. But it hurts even more when the reason for our anguish is the failure of our society to live up to the values it is publicly committed to. We hold our society to task because we believe it ought to know better, especially with regard to those values that have dramatically altered our lives and our life prospects and enhanced them as compared to the lot of our grandparents in Europe a generation or two ago, or in Asia and Africa to this very day. The committed citizen will therefore be the one who seeks to enhance the value commitment of the polity. The social critic not only practices commitment by publicizing the values of the society, he then goes on to equip fellow citizens with the political discourse that will empower them. The social critic thus enhances the democratic quality of the republic. People need words. Better arguments need articulation. Our political lives are permeated with hard cases and tough choices. Given the complexity of our distributive claims and the momentous quality of many political choices, this is perhaps inescapably so. We have often to decide between the lesser of evils. A just war is nevertheless war. Dirty hands are therefore an ongoing feature of our political lives, even of those most responsible and conscientious among us. Walzer's mapping out of the realm of politics does not only provide a framework for elaborating the claims of justice in all their complexity. He is constantly seeking to better understand our political life and to clarify the human political predicament. He constantly shuns the temptation of escapism. Whether this escapism takes on the guise of a liberal circumventing of democratic deliberation, or the more wholesale post-structuralist dismissal of the relevance of institutionalized political engagement. Shunning escapism helps guard Walzer from the pitfalls of an amoral, if not all too cruel or downright immoral, political realism. It also guards him from utopianism. Walzer's political writings are replete with the manifold examples of human political living characterized by ever new questions and relentlessly nagging dilemmas. Walzer's classic contribution to the elaboration of the problem of dirty hands masterfully displays him drawing the contours of these possibilities. To Salt's question, "Do you think you can govern innocently?" Walzer replies, and I quote, "No, I do not think I could govern innocently, nor do most of us believe that those who govern us are innocent, even the best of them. But this does not mean that it isn't possible to do the right thing while governing." End quote. It is this complexity that the realist denies. As Machiavelli famously argued, the prince must learn how not to be good, to cite Donne again. "In this world's warfare, they who rugged fate, God's commissary, doth so thoroughly hate, as in the court squadron marshal the state, if they stand armed with silly honesty, with wishing prayers and neat integrity, like Indians against Spanish hosts they be." End quote. The rule-oriented moralist, on the other hand, finds the second horn of the dilemma impossible to concede, and I'll quote Michael again. "It means that a particular act of government may be exactly the right thing to do in utilitarian terms and yet leave the man who does it guilty of a moral wrong. The innocent man afterwards is no longer innocent." Both for the rule-oriented moralist, for the rule-oriented moralist, rules, so the argument runs, safeguard our innocence, and he that follows them will not, ideally perhaps, err, nor compromise his innocence. According to Michael, however, the complexity of our political lives belies both these possibilities, the necessity of obtuse realism and the purity of the moralist. Walzer's profile of the politician begins with, I quote, "a piece of conventional wisdom to the effect that politicians are a good deal worse, morally worse, than the rest of us." And he adds, in parentheses, "it is the wisdom of the rest of us," end quote. And further on, he puts it more concretely, even bluntly. "Here is the moral politician. It is by his dirty hands that we know him. If he were a moral man and nothing else, his hands would not be dirty. And, we might add, he would not be doing his job, the very job we expect of him and delegate to him, most often because we prefer not to do it ourselves. If, on the other hand, he were a politician and nothing else, he would pretend they were clean. Such a one would lack the conscience we desperately require so as to entrust him with the power that we do, the power he wields that is our power and that can always be turned by the unconscionable politician against the citizens he is meant to serve." Now I'd like to turn to the other part of the argument regarding hermeneutics and community. In a democratic society, public deliberation is a crucial implement in rendering transparent both the conflictual nature of our many endeavors and the ulterior motives for which our representatives might engage in furthering policy. The social critic uniquely positions himself in this task, and I quote, "Criticism does not require us to step back from society as a whole, but only to step back from certain forms of power relations within the society. It is not connection, but authority and domination from which we must distance ourselves." End quote. A profiling of the life of an engaged citizen is one that includes the complexity of our moral fiber as a part of its very makeup. Unpacking our political and moral dilemmas is a hermeneutic undertaking in that it is not only a process of clarification. Insofar as we articulate these dilemmas and clarify our possibilities of action, we are also altering the parameters of our agency. In fact, it is this combination of the total and momentous qualities of the political that make political activity a heightened form of agency. This is also why Kantian intentionalism simply won't do. This beside the classic critique of the insufficiency of the categorical imperative in solving dilemmas pointed out by Kierkegaard and Sartre that Walzer seems to follow. Opening the groundwork for the metaphysics of morals, Kant famously declares that it is impossible to conceive anything in the world or even out of it which can be taken for good without qualification except a good will. End quote. This may explain the nature of absolute moral rectitude and guarantee innocence, but it is completely unhelpful for the purposes of a political morality. Inasmuch as the goal of the political component in the couplet political morality is to be effective and to alter the circumstances of our lives, however much it must be guided by our rational thinking, goals, and intentions, politics cannot be relegated to the inner regions of our intentions. It is the Wittgensteinian flavor of Walzer's characterization of the moral dilemma, locating it in a way of life, which also explains the attraction of Aristotelian phronesis to this way of thinking.
It helps understand Aristotle's source of attraction to kindred political philosophers like Chuck Taylor and Alistair MacIntyre of After Virtue. But whereas Aristotle provides an ethics that is a conception of the virtues that would serve as the psychological dispositional embedding of phronesis, Walzer focuses on the argumentative skills that would help clarify the choices faced by the politician or the citizen. Perhaps this preference echoes the intellectual virtues of the Bet Midrash, the Talmudic call of study. Witness Rabbi Yochanan's statement in the Babylonian tractate Kiddushin 33b, generalizations should not be relied on, even if exceptions are listed. In a similar vein, moral skepticism, Walzer would argue, is not the challenge of our political lives, rather the dispelling of the mist attending our dilemmas in real time and the tendencies of the burning issues to muddle our perceptions and cause us to neglect or to forget our priorities and commitments. We are often lost and need assistance in navigating our paths through the thickets of the situation and of, at the times, conflictual claims. We cannot escape them because we are situated in a way of life institutionally encapsulated in an often totalizing way by our polity. Therefore, too, our moral life is to a great degree fashioned and shaped by the horizons afforded by our political membership. Moral skepticism falsely isolates the moral components of our thick civic and communal lives and misleadingly abstracts them. It correspondingly distorts those moralities that are constituted as ultimate rebuttals. Such moralities internalize the skeptic's form of moral abstraction as the agreed-upon character of moral judgment. The social critic is therefore truer to the mark of the discourse of political morality. He is civically invigorating in his articulation and too often noble in his isolation. He too often dreads being right. Basic connection and measured distance from the polity socially position the social critic and enable his critical reflection to be a critical self-reflection of a polity. Though embedded in a polity and a culture, it is true that in order to fulfill his task, he must retain a measured distance. Walzer's social critic therefore not only assumes a specific hermeneutics, he's couched both in a conception of politics and a conception of membership. The latter explains both his critic's commitment and the position that enables the critical undertaking. Walzer's complex theory of membership explains not only the sources of civic commitment, but also the means for ensuring it remains a critical one. Though all-encompassing of our endeavors, the polity does not monistically define our identity. Walzer recognizes that the primary good we distribute to one another is membership in some human community. The unique weight of the polity in this respect is its typical institutionalization of the amassing of power. And this affects our moral lives as well. The polity, we do treat our moral commitments as, our political commitments as moral ones. Yet few of us, Michael argues, have any direct experience of what a country is or what it means to be a member. We often have strong feelings about our country, but we have only dim perceptions of it. As a political community, rather than a place, it is, after all, invisible. We actually see only its symbols, offices, and representatives, end quote. The polity affirms its power and reach at the expense of concreteness, its web of civic connection more vaporous and way of life thin. The community, in contrast, is characterized by its thick way of life and intimacy of belonging. But on Walzer's understanding, in their difference, the polity and community complement each other. If we think of the polity's constitution, not in the sense of a particular document, but in the broader sense of the arrangement of the basic institutions of society, then we can say that this differentiation of tasks is a constitutional separation, and it is as crucial as a circumstance of justice for a democratic republic as are the more formal institutions of separations. The non-governmental web of caring is the most important feature of Walzer's notion of civil society. Therefore, too, it serves as a buffer zone between government and the individual citizen. It is from his essential rootedness in civil society that the social critic can voice reservations of government and castigate. He brings this moral texture to bear upon the agora, the arena where his political voice is articulated and where it is meant to echo. he brings to the agora the thickness of his communal identity, which in turn fortifies him for his task. I'll end by stating that we, alas, in a world of virtual televised politics, in which the agora has all but dissipated as an arena of deliberation, would probably find again John Donne's words more apt, and I quote, "Believe me, sir, in my youth's giddiest days, when to be like the court was a play's praise, plays were not so like courts as courts are like plays." Thank you.
Not a philosopher, and haven't written an academic paper in 25 years, nor graded one in five. And I am a journalist, I suppose a controversial one, and so let me warn you, one of the people in the room, in this room once said, wrote in the New York Review of Books that I was the Beatrice and Sidney Webb of Zionism. That is not a compliment. But I will try to do a narrative, a gritty narrative maybe, and it goes back 53 years. I met Michael and Judy actually 53 years ago. About two-thirds of our lives ago. And I think that understanding Brandeis is a key to understanding Michael Walzer. There were, in the 50s, many off-the-track colleges in America, experimental colleges, daring colleges, Bennington, well, you had to get pregnant before you got a BA degree. Black Mountain, where John Cage taught. Bard, where Hannah Arendt lived for some years. And Brandeis. Brandeis was more ambitious than these colleges and lots of others that grew up in the 50s. It also had something of a structure and a dictatorial president who was brash and skilled and had many enemies. He treated them badly. One of them, Albert Einstein's son-in-law, Rudolf Kaiser, died as an assistant professor of German emeritus. In the early years, the people who hired in the social sciences were Frank Manuel, one of Michael's teachers, one of Michael's adoring teachers, and Max Lerner, with whom Michael, for obviously intellectually delicate reasons, did not have a close relationship, although perhaps characteristically, and not surprisingly, I did. But they were the people who hired for the social sciences. If there were two smart Jews in competition, normally they were Jews, the choice would be made on the basis of whose family had lived or which individual was born closest to Vilna. It's not a bad standard. I mean, aren't half the smart Jews, you know, descendants from Vilna? There were about 1,000 students when Judy and Michael and I God, Judy, I'm now thinking of our maps in Frank Manuel's course. Michael did Judy's map. There were about 1,000 undergraduates, 200 graduates, and 100 professors, roughly. And I will try to give you a portrait of what kind of political community that was, what kind of political community Michael and Judy and I and Michael Sandel a lot later matured in. The first professor at the university was actually an inheritance from the university which had been on the campus which Brandeis inherited. It wasn't exactly a university, it was actually Middlesex Veterinary School, but it did have a humanities department, and the dean of the humanities department was a man called Joseph Israel Cheskis. His brother had been rector of Moscow State University, but he was executed by Stalin. He was a Yiddishist, so he and I had immediate bonds. He was a socialist, and he taught what some students thought was some people thought he taught in Yiddish. In any case, he did teach a course called Russo and Tolstoy. Is it true that you took that, Judy? No. His standard for hiring in the humanities was also proximity to Vilna. Two more symbolic facts are relevant here, and forgive me for focusing or fixing on Cheskis. In the late 30s, he was dean, as I say, of the humanities. Jews couldn't get into the United States unless they had a job. And so as dean at the medical school, a veterinary school, he sent letters to professors of urology, neurology, pediatrics, giving them appointments as professor of medicine at Middlesex Veterinary School. He was subsequently arrested, and he was gotten off the hook by, it's a very small world, by Frank Manuel's brilliant gangster lawyer brother-in-law, Paul T. Smith. Michael, I'm skipping now. Michael went to Greensboro, North Carolina. I think initially for dissent. Dissent somehow had a fund that the New Republic never had to send people all over the world to do reportorial work. This was during, immediately after the sit-downs at the lunch counters in Greensboro, initiated by SNCC, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, a little bit later, not nonviolent at all, but that's another story. And at one of the usual Sunday breakfasts on Hancock Street, we founded something called EPIC, Emergency Public Integration Committee. That was my contribution. I'm pretty good with cheap lines. Anyway, so we had a faculty picket line, and I asked Joseph Cheskis to join it. And he refused. I told him that Herbert Marcuse had said he would join. He said, well, that's another reason not to. Why? We picketed for them. When do they ever picket for us? He said, no, that's not relevant. We will picket for them again, and then they will blame us for all of their tzoras. He had an insight into the world. One more Cheskis tale. In 1959, Norman Mailer came to Brandeis. Michael was already not there, and Judy was already not there, and I was his host. Mailer was Mailer, and suddenly I see Joseph Cheskis getting up from the fourth row, giving a stage whisper to Esther. Esther, fucking, shitting, pissing, and sucking is an old business. And they left. So it gives you something of a insight into what Brandeis was. Brandeis in the 50s actually was the other universities in the 60s. In terms, certainly, of the intensity of ideological confrontation, the center of gravity was more to the left, but in the 60s, in the 50s, there were no weathermen. So it was more to the left, but not quite that left. And let me give you a list of the incandescent professoriate. Abraham Maslow, who put self-actualization into the vernacular. Herbert Marcuse, Louis Kozer, Irving Howe, C. Wright Mills, Hans Girth, Frank Manuel, Philip Rov, a little bit later, Max Lerner, Eric Heller, E. H. Carr, Lewis Mumford, Marie Serkin, Ludwig Lewison, someone who a lot of you should have heard of but probably haven't, Simon Ravadovich. Already in the 50s, Herbert Marcuse was a very showy academic star. I took his history of political theory, and he did not teach Burke. I took two histories of political theory with him, actually. They had different titles and different course numbers. And it's true, I'm a pushover for stars, as Michael is not. And in the second one, he also did not teach Burke. I think it's very significant, and one shouldn't underestimate this. Michael never took a single course of the great star in political theory, Herbert Marcuse. A sympathy for Stalinism and polymorphous perverse was not for Michael Walzer. The So there was a break in the left. There were communists on the faculty. There were certainly communist sympathizers. And then there was this small, stalwart band rotating around, in a certain sense, Irving Howe. Now, Michael and I, when we were already on the faculty at Harvard, wrote a letter to Brandeis alumni arguing that they should not vote for Angela Davis as a trustee. Herbert Marcuse then called us police intellectuals, and he had his revenge by asking Barrington Moore not to invite me and my wife to dinner in Herbert's honor. Now, Betty Moore wasn't a great cook, so it wasn't a great loss. One other little vignette. Herbert Marcuse once gave a party. I was a graduate student at Harvard, and he invited me. And assembled were Paul Sweezy, Alan Sweezy, Paul Baran, Leften Stavrianos. Leften really was Leften. And I was surprised by this cohort. And I said, what is the basis of this coming together? He said, well, we were all veterans of the OSS. We are all veterans of the OSS. And I said, my God, all of you lefties were veterans of the OSS. And he said, not for nothing, Peretz. Not for nothing were we called the Office of Stalin's Stooges. This was not Michael's crowd. Of course, there was this other socialist crowd, and at Brandeis, one might have imagined, actually, that socialism had a future in America. But that was not the issue for Michael, or at least not the prime issue. I have always felt that underpinning the precise delineaments of philosophical positions and functioning, what was essential for Michael was the simple issue of fairness. And fairness is a elemental, sensate, even tactile category. More of these than even justice or prosperity or authority. And while Irving Howe himself, the leader of the group, was not a model of fairness or of modesty, he too distrusted the arrogant calculations of what made societies both orderly and prosperous. In a certain sense, Michael also never craved popularity, although he worked to gain the respect of his peers, and that too by having his arguments be fair. He was never a gotcha speaker or a gotcha writer. Quiet, evident when examined, and also calmly responsive to criticism. An observation. I have never heard Michael say or read in his writing any suggestion of contempt for America. I've just never seen it. And that's quite unusual given the generation or the generations in which Michael has been practicing political philosophy. Not that all American political theorists express some contempt for America. To some, it is a matter of sheer indifference. America is a part of Michael's argument, even intrinsic to it, because, as he said in his quietly devastating essay on Marcuse, in the battle of the intellect, as in every other battle, one can win finally only on the ground. The ground. In 1968, April 1968, the Walzers no longer lived at Hancock Street. I forget the name of the street they lived on. Tom Hayden calls me and says, I want to meet you and Michael. It's a matter of great, great urgency. And I didn't know what to say, and Michael also didn't seem to say that we should say no. So he came over to the house, and he told us of a plot, a conspiracy that he was organizing to show the fascist nature of the state. And it was the plan for the demonstrations and tempting and taunting daily to go out and beat up people and so on. Michael, I think, hadn't the slightest idea of what he was talking about. Most notably among the thinkers on the left, Michael Walzer and Christopher Lash, and he not so much on the left as he aged, maintained a concrete admiration for America. Michael even asking, in a wonderful book, which I reread in the Cincinnati airport yesterday, what it means to be an American. Now, this makes Michael an exception from the rule for intellectuals, American intellectuals, or for the often taken opportunity to be alienated from the American experience and the American experiment. He is also unusual among American Jewish intellectuals in not being alienated from Judaism, Jewry, and Israel. There's a book that perhaps many of you also haven't seen. It's a book called The Other New York Jewish Intellectuals. It was edited by a woman who went to Brandeis, Carol Kessner. And it was published with essays about some men and women who were other. What do I mean by other? They were not Lionel Trilling or Daniel Böll or Irving Howe or Alfred Kazin or Philip Rov, who made their lives in a world dominated by Edmund Wilson, Dwight MacDonald, Mary McCarthy. So who are these lesser, other intellectuals? Chaim Greenberg? Does anybody know Chaim Greenberg in this room? Absolutely, the Israelis know about Chaim Greenberg. Morris Raphael Cohen, you know him. He was an anti-Zionist. Marie Serkin, Ben Halpern, Maurice Samuel, Charles Reznikoff. Marie Serkin was, by the way, she was a very interesting feminist. She had an affair with Mayakovsky. She was married both to Maurice Samuel. Her father aborted the marriage the day after it happened. She was underage. And Charles Reznikoff, who was a wonderful poet and who influenced a lot of American poets, and she said to me once, I'm coming to the end. She said to me once, you know, I was sure that I was married for 50 years to a schlemiel. And then when my schlemiel died, Robert Lowell came to see me and to tell me how great Reznikoff was. Serkin had a tremendous influence on Michael and me, Leon Wieseltier. He wasn't a Brandeis guy. I confess that I have stronger affinities to these men and women than to the others. I do not intend to force an affinity on Michael that he may not want. But it is my experience, reading his writing on Jewish issues, hearing him speak on Israel and Zionism, seeing the light in his eyes when he is among kindred Jews, that he too is a part of the group of others. Thank you.
I will ask Michael to come and respond for up to 10 minutes.
Well, I'm sure that Marty and I could talk for a very long time about our history together, and he is entirely right to focus on Brandeis as a key moment in the shaping of my future intellectual life, and my future political life. It all happened there. I came to Brandeis from Johnstown, Pennsylvania, and it was like coming into the world. But it was a very, very peculiar world, a very special world, where we were taught Marxism by people who were no longer Marxists. And we listened to the arguments of Stalinists and Trotskyites long after those voices were still almost everywhere else. And as Marty said, the 60s came in the 50s, we were the right age. By the time the other 60s came, we were too old. But because of Brandeis, we enjoyed the first 60s in our late teens and 20s. And that experience of living with those people, the people on Marty's list, has really shaped everything I did, and I don't think that my graduate education at Harvard ever equaled my undergraduate education at Brandeis. I'm going to try to say something about the kind of social criticism that I want to do, and as it was elucidated by Mitchell and Menachem. And it begins with the insistence that that the source of social criticism is everyday complaint, common complaint, not high theory, but the simple fact about social life that we all complain about it. The simple fact about our government that we all complain about it. And my emphasis on common complaint has been so strong that a friend told me that the fundamental maxim of my social criticism was oive ergo sum. And I have constructed the critical project out of or starting from common complaint, and that has two consequences, I think. And the first is a rejection of critical distance, as it is usually described. As it is usually described when it is described as a fundamental feature of the critical project. Some distance is absolutely necessary. I've said that it should be measured in inches. What's wrong with critical distance in its frequent expression is that distance is taken as a source of authority. The more distant I am from this society, the greater the distance from which I look at it, the more authority I have over it. And that is a view, that's what Mitchell called hubris, which I have always been very skeptical about. The claim, speak truth to power, is very attractive until you encounter critics who intend to seize power in order to enforce their version of the truth. So when truth has that kind of, when truth underwrites that claim to rule over others, we need to be skeptical. My first book was about the Puritan Revolution, and I've always remembered a line from Oliver Cromwell, which I think has to be central. It's not a Jewish line. Central to the project of social criticism. Think ye in the bowels of Christ, Cromwell said to a group of Presbyterian ministers, think ye in the bowels of Christ that ye may be wrong. And that's every critic needs when he confronts his society and wags his finger at societies, most of which need to be criticized, need to have the finger wagging. He must think that he may be wrong. And the second feature of social criticism, which derives from common complaint, which Menachem stressed, is that it is a political project. We want to make our complaints effective. We want to join as much as we can in the work of changing this society, and in order to do that, we have to work with our fellow citizens in this in this society. And that's what Menachem calls joining the discussion. We have to join the discussion without any claim to rule over it, without any claim that we have priority in rightness or truth over our fellow citizens. We have to join the discussion arguing with them. And we have to find the language which makes the argument possible. And that is the democratic project. And that's a project that requires the use of everyday speech. And that's why I've always been skeptical about the tendency among academics to develop esoteric language, to develop jargons, which often perhaps are which may enable them to get things right or to say things more precisely, but which cut us off from the people that we need to be talking to as social critics. We have other roles to play, and as academics and as philosophers, perhaps we may need to talk to each other in specialized languages. But when we are critics, we must join the discussion with our fellow citizens. And that's something I think that I first learned to do at Brandeis in an organization that we formed there called SPEAK, the Student Political Education and Action Committee, the first of many such organizations that I have belonged to and whose statements I have signed, trying in every case to make sure that they were written in English and that they were understandable, first of all, to me. That's the project, I think, to which the critic must be committed. Thank you.
Okay, George Cater. You have to wait for the, otherwise they won't count as speak.
Okay, yes. Mr. Peretz, Herbert Marcuse was my teacher, but not at Brandeis, but at Columbia. And I want to say to you, for the sake of the record, two things about Herbert Marcuse. I'm afraid you misrepresented him rather seriously, twice, not once. He was a critic of Norman O. Brown, who coined the phrase polymorphous perversity, and Marcuse wrote a pained but unmistakably critical article on one of Norman O. Brown's later books for Norman Podhoretz, in commentary. So he didn't espouse polymorphous perversity. He was appalled by it as a human aspiration. The second thing is to call him a Stalinist also misrepresents him. If he had sympathies for any of the Soviet leaders, it probably would have been for Lenin or Trotsky, but not Stalin. He wrote a book called Soviet Marxism, which is a very subtle but also severe criticism of currents of thought that Stalin especially had set going in the Soviet Union. So if you want to dislike Marcuse, I guess that's all right. I think his work will live, actually. and it's already coming back somewhat. He was a totally scrupulous, even if one-eyed, critic. And it's not helpful to the cause of what you stand for, it seems to me, to make little of this man and also to misrepresent him. And one last point, if I may. I think Michael's essay on Marcuse is, of course, as with everything Michael writes, stimulating and perceptive, but it is too unconnected in the imagination of Marcuse to do justice to Marcuse. He is someone worth your time, I would say. And thank you for letting me sound off.
Sure. I will describe. Look, I've read Soviet Marxism and Eros and Civilization and the other touchstone books. I was at a meeting in the castle, which was a Brandeis dormitory, just as the Hungarian Revolution was being fought out. And Louis Kozer spoke, and a man called Milton Sachs, who I don't know whether he ever wrote anything, and Marcuse was on the panel. A lot of people were confused by the revolution because they had illusions about the dictatorship. And this is not a quote, but it's pretty close. Herbert got up. He was quite tall, and so he stooped a little bit over the lectern. His glasses were down at the end of his nose, and he said, "I do not trust a revolution sponsored by Walter Donovan." Walter Donovan, I think, was the head of the OSS, actually, the organization he had worked for. And if there is a choice between American machinations, that wasn't his word, and young men and women of the Soviet Army, I choose the Soviet Army. Not a fabrication. In his I think that's the true Herbert Marcuse. I remember him ridiculing my Zionism. I think there was a tremendous. He was a public man and he was a private man, and the private man actually was uglier than the public man. I was at Yad Vashem, and suddenly there's a row of pictures of German Jews who left Germany. And there's a picture of Herbert, and of course he was a Jew, but he didn't give a damn about the survival of Jews or Jewish peoplehood anywhere. So anyway, that's all.
Moving right along. Tim.
I'd like to pick up on Michael's splendid remarks about different styles of criticism. And I think this makes a connection with what Menachem and Mitchell had to say as well. I think that the difference between the philosophical approach and the social critic approach that Michael represents and has spoken so well for is easy to exaggerate. I think we all start from a sense of grievances. What are those grievances? We want to, if we think there's an objection to inequality, then the question is why? What's bad about it? How can we articulate what the grievance is? I think that's where we're all starting. But I do think there's a difference, and maybe appreciating this suggestion about the difference may help to indicate why the difference isn't all that large, even though it exists. The social critic, as Mitchell and Menachem described them, may start from the accepted meanings, the ideas and the values that are out there, but he or she is always making a selection, because the ideas that the social milieu provides at any one time aren't consistent, for one thing. You got to put them together to articulate the grievances, is selecting which are the things that are really going on here, what's really making this inequality or this injustice objectionable. So in that sense, I think Bazarov, there's something right about Bazarov, that is, a social critic who's honest is not just saying, this is what we all think, because there are lots of things that we all think. He or she's making a selection, say, this is what I think is important among the various things. So there's a prior stage of criticism, before you join the conversation, of making a selection, of deciding where you stand and what you think, so that you can then enter the conversation. And so I think the difference between, if there is a difference between the styles and approaches that Michael's describing, I think it's a difference in the degree of emphasis that's placed on these two, as it were, different stages in social criticism. One is the stage when you yourself are deciding, what do I think is the real basis of the complaint here? Which of the various different objections that might be raised seems to me to be the one that's getting at the heart of the matter. There, Bazarov is half right. That is, he's got to decide what he thinks. Now, of course, he's arrogant if he doesn't even want to hear what anybody else thinks, because there's always the question, why shouldn't he think that too? If he's making a selection, he's got to consider all the things that he's selecting among. So it's not that what other people think isn't at all relevant, but they don't settle it. He's got to make a selection. And I think that as we enter, of course, we may change our mind about the selection once we enter into the dialogue, but there is a question when we first enter into it of what we're going to advocate for. And what's out there provides us with materials, but it leaves this other question, it seems to me, unanswered. So the social meanings that are there are important, but the selection process has to decide which ones are the ones that really matter, not because they're there, but because they matter.
Could I just exercise the prerogative of the chair and add something to that and invite either Michael or the other two panelists to say more? Because it does seem to me that it's really a false dichotomy to claim that there's at root a deep difference between philosophical argument and this sort of criticism that Michael engages in. I find myself thinking, how do you distinguish common complaint from whining? How do you distinguish social critics from spoiled brats? How do you decide what criticism is valid and should be acted upon? It seems to me connected social criticism is a very important method of argument, but at the end of the day, it doesn't tell you what to say, doesn't tell you which criticism should be advanced and why, and which criticism should be ignored or diffused. And in order to make those kinds of arguments or those kinds of decisions, you do actually need a philosophical argument of some sort. It's just seems to me all the way going back to in the American tradition to Dewey's and pragmatism or the legal realist, this the idea that understanding a problem in all of its rich contextual complexity is still going to be, no matter how rich one's understanding of contextual complexity, is still going to be underdetermined in terms of what should actually be done about it. There will always be possible courses of action that are consistent with some interpretation of the rich contextual complexity, and philosophical decisions will have to be brought to bear on that complexity, and choices will have to be made. So I'll put that out there and see if anyone wants to pick it up.
Okay, I will. I'm just jotting down what I want to say. Okay. I think that no one would deny the centrality of reflection to an effective social criticism. And reflection involves also certain second-order capabilities. That's not the point. I think that the fear is the moments when reflection turns into, is kind of transposed into a self-absorption. And that happens all the time in the way people talk about political matters. They stop at a certain point speaking about politics and are intertwined in, or in, become very involved in something very different. And I think it's that moment that the argument is focusing on. It's not on the importance of enriching our capacity for reflection, second order analysis, and the kind of also arguments we equip ourselves with. It's what we do with them. And I think what's distinctive about the way Michael goes about doing it is whenever you speak to Michael, you know that his fingers are on the pulse of the political life, of the polities he's very strongly involved with, but not only those polities. He's really interested in what's going on in politics in the world, and often the problem is, I think the problem is when for a moment of reflections turn into a wholesale disdain. It's when it becomes a wholesale disdain, then people stop becoming engaged in political discussion in an effective manner. I think that's the issue that has to be addressed, not philosophy per se.
I'm just making a sort of associated point, which is I started by asking, you know, should we trust intellectuals? And I think that partly raises the problem. I think the notion of social criticism as a corrective to a certain type of political intellectual argument is at least what I was trying to stress. And I would ask a different question. I would ask someone, an intellectual who's politically involved, the question of why are you politically engaged? And is it because of the society, or is it because of your self-image as an intellectual? And I think that's part of the very, very strong points to which social criticism responds. One point on Bazarov in Turgenev's novel is that throughout the novel he has conversations where it's really only him speaking. No one listens, and the only two points where he's unsure of himself and confused is when he finds that he's falling in love and that shouldn't happen, and when he's dying, and he's not sure whether the country needs people like him or not.
Hang on. Michael wanted to get in there.
I'm very sad that Axel Honneth isn't here, because of illness in the family he couldn't come. He wrote the most critical paper of my view of social criticism. All of these friends gave me the benefit of every doubt. But his paper was quite genuinely critical, and the issue between us was whether high theory in the style of the Frankfurt School is necessary to social criticism. And I had given a paper at the 75th anniversary of the founding of the Institute for Social Research, where I argued that high theory was neither necessary nor sufficient for social criticism, though a good social theory could be very, very helpful. But I elaborated many examples of people with good social theories who wrote terrible social criticism. Horkheimer, I think, was one of those. And people without any social theory who produced very good social criticism. And so I do think that the moment of theoretical insight, the moment of philosophical insight, can be enormously important to a critic. But I want to suggest that it isn't necessary, and that it also isn't enough. Sometimes the criticism begins, and this is what I mean by common complaint. It begins from something like, well, think of the medieval, the critique of feudal hierarchy in the Middle Ages based on Christian or biblical egalitarianism. When Adam delved and Eve span, who was then the gentleman? That's not high theory. And it's not philosophy. But you can build from that line a very, very powerful critique of the feudal hierarchy. And that's one way of doing it, and it's a way that I want to appreciate, but I don't want to deny that there are other ways.
My name's Jeremiah Reamer. I was a student in one class of yours back in 1974. I'm glad that Axel Honneth was brought up, because I wanted to ask if people on the panel had read his paper and what they thought of his proper or perhaps misperception of Walzer's work as a social critic. But you brought it up. You quoted, maybe you have some thoughts about how you are perceived not as a connected critic in the United States or in Jewish or Israeli questions, but in some other countries. I happen to have read your Exodus and Revolution in German translation first. I think Axel Honneth might have written the introduction. I've always been puzzled by how I think you're viewed in Germany as a communitarian, generally. I'm also puzzled by this whole question of a connected critic, because there is a long tradition of German Jewry in which it could be said that most German Jews from the Kaiserreich through the Weimar Republic basically wanted a more liberal, democratic order with a certain degree of social justice. And it always struck me that your kind of connected criticism of ordinary democracy was actually what most German Jews were plugging for all along. Actually, I think they have that kind of ordinary democracy right now and could use some connected critics of your kind talking about it. But when most German Jews, speaking of other intellectuals, when most Germans today think of a Jewish intellectual, they think of someone who is esoteric, hypercritical, messianic, recondite, concerned with aesthetics more than with politics and so on. You just mentioned that quote from the Middle Ages. That's something that Ernst Bloch also cites. And he's thought of as more of a Jewish intellectual critic than you, though you're quoting the same source. I'll just leave it at that.
Okay. I don't know how I am viewed from various European perspectives. It is true that when I speak in Germany, I am almost always introduced as an American Jewish philosoph. And when I speak in France, that's not part of the introduction, usually not part of the introduction, and in Italy, not part of the introduction, and in Spain, not part of the introduction. Recently, when I lectured in China, I was introduced at great length as an American Jewish philosopher because the person introducing me had gotten it into his head that a Jewish philosopher would be very sympathetic to Confucianism, and that there was this important link because they have texts and we have texts and they do interpretation and we do interpretation and they have strong families and we supposedly have strong families. And so the Jewish connection was stressed there. And it is stressed in Germany and not, I think, in any other of the European countries.
I see no other hands. We'll, where? Oh, Amy, yeah, I'm sorry.
So there's another distinction between connected and less connected social criticism, which I think Michael represents in his teaching and writing, and actually goes to something that Tim and others on the panel have said. And that's the difference between feeling, thinking that one needs as comprehensive theory of the world, a philosophy, a ideology as possible in order to make the selection of complaints and to get the right perspective, or thinking that it's just maybe too hard to do that in human affairs and maybe we should be somewhat suspicious of people who have comprehensive philosophies which they need to guide them to make the complaints. And not to make this too striking a dichotomy too, but Michael taught all the great philosophers I wrote. He introduced me to Hegel, not because he was a Hegelian, but because he thought it was important to read the comprehensive philosophies. But I've always been struck, and I wonder what Michael and the panelists think, by doubt about why, about comprehensive philosophies being able to hold the truth if you find a mathematical proof that has an error in it. You reject the proof, it's just wrong. But I defy anybody to give me a moral or political philosopher in any of the syllabi that Michael taught, that I've taught, where there isn't an error that we can find, and we teach our students to find those errors. And if that's the case, I think if we're searching and we think the selectivity can only be by finding the right philosophy, none of us has it. And we would be foolish to reject these wonderful theories wholesale because they have errors in them, which they all do, and inconsistencies. And if they don't have inconsistencies, they're probably less rich than the ones that do. So connected social criticism, yes, but also, and philosophies are neither necessary nor sufficient for good social criticism, but all the philosophies that Michael assigned, and I think that most of us who've taught have assigned, have, including Marcuse, have insights in them. The great ones, the ones that live on and are read on, have insights in them that help us be better social critics, and the ones we reject, the errors that we find, also help us to be better. I guess that's a comment more than a question, but it is a reflection, I think, on why I have been so attracted to the style of social criticism that Michael represents, because it doesn't demonize philosophies that make serious mistakes or have the wrong political allegiances. It encourages students like me, who then grow up to be no longer Michael's students, but critics of Michael and sympathetic critics, to make the best of the practice of philosophy and social criticism. Sorry for going on that long.
In the piggybacking mode, I'll add something to Amy's comment and then offer all the panelists some time to say any final words, including Michael, if he's so moved. I think Amy raises some important questions, but it seems to me important to distinguish skepticism about architectonic systems from skepticism about commitment to the truth. Everything you've been saying presumes truth is a kind of regulative ideal that's important in argument. And it seems to me that the notion of connected criticism undersells what Michael does as a social critic, in that he is committed to things other than the common complaints through which he examines common complaints. And it seems to me there are two. One is a commitment to the truth as a regulative ideal in discourse and argument. And in his own work, it's exemplified by his never taking cheap shots or scoring ad hominem points and being outraged when people do that to him, and recognizing that commitment to truth-telling is an important regulative ideal. The other, I think, is a normative commitment to the idea of non-domination. It's the way he unpacks equality. I don't think in spheres of justice it's simply affirmed because it's a principle in a liberal society. I think Michael's discussions of other societies affirm it as well. And it seems to me that I would characterize it not simply as connected criticism, but as principled criticism geared to minimizing domination in the world. Now, people can ask philosophical questions about why one should be committed to truth-telling if all you are is a connected critic, and why you should be committed to opposing domination if all you are is a connected critic. And it seems to me that inevitably you're going to engage philosophical questions. I completely take Michael's point that some people who are good at that are terrible social critics, and some effective social critics can do that implicitly, perhaps, and couldn't articulate it explicitly. But that seems to me not to deny the essential point that we started with Tim Scanlon, that these are not mutually exclusive activities, but mutually complementary ones. So having said that, why don't we go in reverse order with our three panelists, and then we will, if he wants it, give Michael the last word. Marty.
It occurs to me that William Graham Sumner once taught a course at Yale called A Course in All Known Knowledge. And of course, it wasn't, but it was a contribution anyway. So I think, Amy, you're absolutely right. No more.
I'll just add that I think, Amy, of course, you're right. Great works, first of all, teach us a lot about thinking a problem through, which is a crucial lesson to learn. And the other thing, I've spent about
6 years working on the new Hebrew translation of Leviathan. I don't think that Hobbes is the truth about politics, but I think a great work creates a space in which key notions can resonate. And this has very important work to do in the cultural underpinnings of our political discourse. Think about you know, if you can raise, if a generation, for example, of students is raised on an absorption, for example, of a work like Leviathan, then the thought experiment of a state of nature and a social covenant is one that resonates very strongly for them, whatever work it'll continue doing for them. This part of developing what I call the resonance of our political language, and I think and both together our political imagination in terms of our ability to conceptualize and to work out arguments, I think is crucial to the kind of social criticism one can do. It's the temptation of getting lost in one's thought that the great systems sometimes create that really have the danger of rendering us mute at the most important moments. And that's the issue that we have, I think, most to be careful of. And in this sense, being obscure is no different than being mute.
And I think I want to touch on what Amy said and connect it to one of the great problems of the left in the 20th century and to where I think Michael's work works as a powerful corrective against it. Since you mentioned Hegel, it's of course in the phenomenology of mind where Hegel says the whole is the true. And I think certainly when it comes to politics, one of the lessons of the 20th century is that the whole ends up being much more than it's cracked up to be. And the result of that has been pretty disastrous. And so certainly better not to seek the philosophical whole. The antidote to that being politically social criticism and pluralism, and I think that's an answer within the left to this problem that was posed, I think, repeatedly in the 20th century.
I do want to accept what Ian said about a commitment to or an opposition to domination being a very central feature of my and our critical project. But I do think that commitment does begin from common complaint, and that's because of a belief I have and have always had, which may be wrong. Think ye that ye may be wrong. That in no human society do the subjects of domination, the victims of domination, accept their condition, really accept it, fully accept it. And in every human society, there is evasion, resistance, opposition, and the critical project begins from the evasions, the resistances, the secret opposition of the dominated against domination.
Well, let me thank everybody for participating and terminate for today.